Thank you very much for rattling off so many numbers, Abhishek. We have an expert tell us where the price is reflecting the value. Shantanu Chakraborty, head of banking financial research, company research, and senior vice president at Edelweiss Financial Services, joins us. Shantanu, good morning. Thank you very much. Should we be prepared for any unexpected shocks on the asset quality? You know, there is this second wave, and then there is this interest on interest, which at the moment RBI is saying that it has to be provided for. And third and the worst, all that was restructured up until December and which has not been completely restructured has to first be recognized as NPL. And then next quarter, if they are restructured, they can be treated as standard. Will all this mean some shocks on asset quality?
Right, Lata. I mean, you know, as Abhishek was also mentioning in the previous segment, at least the pro forma SMA 0 on 2 numbers which were given out in the last quarter clearly indicated that the numbers were flattered by the forbearances, whether they came from Supreme Court or in the previous period, in the moratorium period. So there were assets in various stages of irregularity which were not captured in the headline numbers, so to speak. However, I would venture that the market probably factored most of that in and was very aware of the fact that headline asset quality as it is would probably peak out in another quarter or two, maybe by middle of next financial year. To my mind, the fact that those numbers are going to pan out is not that much of a negative surprise. What has changed, I think, from current COVID is that it has raised two questions. The first one relates to provisioning, that is credit costs. I think we could have had a material expectation of a large credit cost unwind starting this quarter if this last wave had not come around. As you'd be well aware, certain banks, especially ones like ICICI Axis, have provisions standing well in excess of what could be considered as the total pool of, you know, assets which are in any shape or form irregular, whether it's restructured SMA or overdue of any other sort. So that unwinding could have started in earnest, but I really think that given how the uncertainties have shaped up in the last 2 to 3 weeks, a lot of the provisioning policy is probably going to err on the side of caution, and you're going to probably get a lot less release than you'd have otherwise expected. So credit costs, yes, on a year-on-year basis, of course, it's going to look like a much shrunk number because on the year-on-year comparable, the COVID provisioning numbers had started kicking in, the discretionary provisioning that the banks were doing. But on a sequential basis, the large improvement that you could have noticed probably is not going to come around in this quarter, which means that the credit cost unwind now becomes a story of FY22 and not of this quarter. However, you know, on a sequential basis also, the numbers are not going to look horrible as far as credit cost is concerned. The second worry, which a lot of players have, and I think that is the bigger open question, is going to be that, you know, can we use the total number of overdue / irregular loans as of close of Q3 as in some sense the mother load of the total problem size? Because, you know, if... Or are there completely regular assets that have been regular through the whole of last year? And this time round, the soft lockdowns in whatever form is creating incremental stress on them. And I would venture actually that given the nature of the lockdowns which have happened so far, probably using that total stress number from Q3 is not such a bad idea. If a business has been regular in its payments through the last 12 months, odds are that it's probably not going to get as added to the asset pool, because you'd see that the segmental pattern of stress in this lockdown, or let's not call it a lockdown, or any sort of restrictions which have happened, is going to be very similar in terms of...
Okay, got that point. I've got the point, Shantanu. You know, it's slightly, you know, press for time, pre-market is open. I wanted your thoughts in particular on some of these big private banks, especially names like HDFC Bank, where there's been a bit of a worry. What kind of, you know, earnings are you expecting here? And, you know, let me throw in an ICICI and Axis as well.
Right. So, as far as earnings are concerned, I think you're still going to see some growth. Of course, there's been restriction on their new digital business because of the RBI order that came in following the disruption of their MIS. But nevertheless, I would expect that, I mean, they have already disclosed their top line numbers, so we know what the loan growth is. And even at a profitability level, I mean, close to $1 billion kind of profit in the quarter, I think is quite doable. And from that point of view, it should not come as too much of a shock to their overall earnings profile, well in excess, at least $1.1 billion kind of number we have for their earnings for the
Okay,
quarter.
no, Shantanu, I think what Anuj is asking is whether HDFC Bank's loss is going to be ICICI and SBI and Axis's gain, especially in terms of credit card customers. And let me add my own question. Will you pay a little attention to the Federals and the DCBs and the mid-cap banks?
So, yeah, first questions first. Yes, of course, in the short term, I mean, and this has already got reported in the various meetings, etc., that all the banks have been doing, that yes, there's been a market share gain opportunity because one of the largest and most prominent players in the market has been on an artificial pause for the last 3 months, no doubt about it. But is that material enough to either change the earnings profile of the quarter or, for that matter, the outlook for the long term for that business? I don't think so. I think the entire market share scenario probably mean reverts the moment HDFC opens up post this quarter. That's my take on that. Now, regarding your question regarding mid-cap banks and what our thoughts on those are, unfortunately, the provisioning, excess provisioning levels for a lot of mid-cap banks, I mean, there are some notable exceptions, but it is not of a similar order or of magnitude as some of these larger banks. So any uncertainty related to the second phase of COVID infections probably offers you a lot less protection in these mid-cap banks than it does for the larger well-provided banks. And that's why, and remember, these are also the leverage is generally much higher than that for the larger private banks, so to speak. So as of now, the only mid-cap idea that we have been pushing has been AU Bank, which has done very well for us. But other than that, our preferences are to stick with HDFC, ICICI, Axis, and SBI.
Okay, so those are the larger banks. Within the mid-cap space, I mean, overall, what are your top picks in the sector as a whole?
So the banks are the ones which we said from the mid-cap group of banks, and we are only picking AU. On the NBFC side, we like the Shriram Twins, we like LIC Housing Finance, we also like HDFC. Although the return expectation there is a little lower than the other names, but given the quality, it still makes sense.
Okay.
And within
Sorry, Shantanu, we'll invite you again for the NBFC piece. Thank you very much for your observations on the banking stocks. Okay, because Shantanu started off with NBFC, we are going to give you a little more on that. Fitch Ratings has written an interesting report on the impact of the second wave of COVID on NBFCs. They say companies now face renewed asset quality and even liquidity risks. That is, either people, borrowers not.